My name is Mervyn Eads. I'm a Noongar man connected to the Wheelerman and Menang clan groups of the southwest of WA, Noongar country. My life has been entrenched in lots of trauma, both emotionally, physically, and you know, just systemic related issues. It all stems back from invasion and colonisation, as far as I'm concerned, and that's what my people feel. My life story. I grew up in a country town called Cranbrook. After I was brought back to Cranbrook I spent the first few years, a couple of years of my life in Nagala, which is a home for children, and Bridgewater. And my grandparents came and got me from there, and my dad, and took me back to the country hometown where my family all grew up. And it's a little town called Cranbrook, gateway to the Stirling Ranges. And my grandmother and my grandfather, I pay all dues and respects to them for what they did for me growing me up and all that there. And they're both rest in peace now. But I always like to acknowledge what they did for me, and played a major role in my life, along with my uncles and extended families, aunties and all that there. Grew up in that sort of environment. We didn't have much, but we always battled at that. But what we did have was love, and lots of love from our families, and the grandmother and grandfather always made sure that we always had love, and the respect, and always taught respect and respect for our elders and all that sort of stuff, and all people, no boundaries with who they are and where they're come from. But I've always had a soft spot for the less fortunate, because I grew up less fortunate, you know what I mean? I've never walked past the people that's still, I see living like our old people used to. I've never walked past them, the drunks in the street. I've never walked past them, because some of the best people in my life were our colleagues, and some of the drunks that used to sit around the parks and all that. Yeah, but from the early age of 13, I first was introduced to incarceration, imprisonment. And from the age of 13, I first went into the prison system, Longmore Detention Centre, which is a juvenile detention centre in Perth. And from then onwards, went through that system of prison, you know what I mean? From the age of 13, and I stopped going to prison at 31. Today I'm 46. I've been out for 14 years now, which is great. But everything that led me to the going to prison was, we didn't have much, and my crimes was not of want, and nor are the crimes of my people. It's not crimes that we want, it's crimes of need. We commit our crimes of need because of the social impact upon our people in society. We are the we live in one of the world's richest countries, yet we are the poorest people. And I don't understand it still today. I don't understand it. We have the highest incarceration rates and every high rate of any person we have. And what really, really hurtful and is hit home to me is the highest incarceration rate of any Indigenous youth in the world is home, where I come from, and it's my people and my First Nations people. We are the highest incarcerated children, and we still have that today, 2016. After 230 years of invasion and that, it's all real. It's realistic and it's happening. And when they first landed upon our shores and invaded our country, I see that we were in shackles, and had chains around our necks and feet and that. And today we are still the highest incarcerated, still with handcuffs on us, but in the wider society and the community, we have invisible shackles that no one sees, but they're around us, and they're tied pretty tight to our people. But growing up through all those years and in and out of the prison system and all that there, as you know, it's not a nice life. It took some of the best years of my life away, and it took me a long time to realise that prison wasn't the right way in that. And well, I've always realised there was a gap in the community where our people had nothing. And I designed Nullarmaya. I'm the managing director there, and I created opportunities for our brothers and sisters and our youth getting out of the prison system to help turn their lives around through education, training and employment, and industry-driven employment opportunities that we have designed and manufactured. And I've also designed the WA Women's Reintegration Program for our women. That's our mums. Our mums and the children's mums and our sisters that are locked up there with nothing. And you know what I mean? I wanted to do something for them because a lot of our mothers are being incarcerated at a high rate now, and no one knows why. They say we don't understand, but I do. A lot of their children are still being ripped from their arms and that, put into care and all that sort of stuff. And you know, the systemic trauma is placed upon them, then they go doing hitting hard drugs and alcohol to hide their pain of having their babies ripped from their arms and that by Department of Child Protection and police and that, and yeah, agencies that make money off our children's care. You know what I mean? And they say our people can't care for the children. I don't understand that. This is coming from people that's been here for 230 years. Our children and our people have existed for 60,000 years. Our mothers are very capable, I think. As the oldest culture and people in the world, we are the survivors. Yeah, but I'm giving something back to my community and my Noongar people and all the people in West Australia, coming out of the prison systems, that burnt a fire in me. And, you know, for the last 3 years, I don't get paid, no funding. We're a not-for-profit organisation. We haven't been government-funded. But we have proven stats that delivery of service from our people to our people really works. And, you know, that fire within me burns and burns. And I like what I'm doing because I know I'm helping some people some of my people that are going through what I went through, and, you know, just giving a little bit back to them and showing that they have, they are worthy, and there is hope. And if we've got to instill hope from ourselves to them, well, I love doing what I do, creating opportunities for our brothers and sisters. We've got this going on in my country at the moment, and it's a native title, under native title, Indigenous Land Use Agreement. Mm-hmm. That's their determination and wording for it. What I call it, a land grab, taking away something that belongs to our people and wanting to give us nothing for it, you know, just chips. But they don't understand the significance that this land holds for our people and for generations before us and generations after us. This will impact on our people severely. When they talk about Indigenous Land Use Agreement, where they wish for us to relinquish and surrender our rights to them for money. Me, I say, no, money can't buy my land. No amount of money can buy my heritage and culture and spirituality that lies in the land. No money in the world could buy our culture that lies in the land, but it should never ever be asked of us to sell our spirituality and our connection to land and all the cultural identity that lies in the land, our storylines, our songlines that connect our people to every other Aboriginal or First Nations people in Australia. You know what I mean? And it's an Indigenous Land Use Agreement to me also asks for me to surrender my rights to my sovereignty. My sovereign rights have never been ceded, nor shall they be ceded, to no land use agreement. And especially when we're talking about a significant area of my Noongar people's land, which covers nearly, as you can see here, to what we are talking about here is 200,000 square kilometres of land. The government wants our Noongar people to relinquish and surrender all rights to the land for $1.3 billion. And as you can see, all the yellow parts, the extinguished parts, and all the grey parts are pastoralist lands, occupied lands, still stolen lands, no matter which way they look at it or want to say it. But the little tiny black spots on this map is what they want to give us in return for their $1.3 billion, but take away from us 200,000 square kilometres from Durian Bay in the north to Albany in the south and across to Ravensthorpe, which is massive and huge. They couldn't buy two streets in Perth for $1.3 billion, or we couldn't. Our First Nations people wouldn't be able to buy one street. You know, but yet they want us to extinguish all our rights to the land, all our land, for their filthy dollar. Their filthy dollar that is built upon our land and created from our land. And all of this, you know, their money comes from our land, they are in our land, uninvited, as invaders. They govern our lands and they dictate and govern and tell our people what's good for us and all that sort of stuff. But they have the cheek to ask our people to do an Indigenous land use agreement for sustainability and economical device for our people, and so we are sustainable. So they want to give us money for us to surrender our rights to our holiness. Our holiness lies within the land and the country, and you know, they will never understand the Westminster government that runs their law upon our lands. They will never understand the cultural and the spiritual belonging that we have to our land. And I really don't understand. I look at it and make it similarities to the Pope selling all his churches in the world. Has anyone asked the Pope to sell his churches? I don't think so, but what's happening in Australia is our people are asking to sell our identity and our culture and everything that lies in our land. And no, it's not for sale. It can never be for sale because we can't, also, we cannot speak for generations to come. The unborn, that is their birthright to this land. And we can't sell their birthright. We can't make decisions on behalf of unborn children and children that are going to be born in another 100 or 1,000 years. We can't determine that, nor should we ever be asked that, and nor should our First Nations land councils, our Noongar land council, should never have been entertaining such rubbish. We've been here forever, from the beginning of time, as far as I'm concerned. Our people are the oldest people and culture in the world, and they try and date it when we was here. I say we was here from the beginning of a time, and this place, Australia, before we invaded, was the Garden of Eden, and it's old, so much significant to our people. But the connection with our fellow brothers and sisters from one side of Australia to the other cannot be broken, and this land deal will break that. If they take the land and they destroy any significant place, like they have been, deregistering in WA, 300 sites have been deregistered in the last 3 or 4 years or something. If they actually destroy one of these sites that connects our song lines to other people's song lines, they will break a link in our culture and heritage that has existed for thousands and thousands of years. We can't have that. And the government's asking us to surrender our land, and what for? So they can reap the wealth and the benefits of our land. On Noongar country, we've never been mined yet. They did the Pilbara, the Kimberleys, they've raped and pillaged their land, and what they're asking us for is to surrender our rights so they can rape and pillage our lands with mining and that, and pay us out of our own dirt. And I don't think it's right, and nor should any First Nations people or any of our land councils entertain such rubbish as any land use agreements it's about time the Australian government pay the rent for the 228 years they've been here.